The internet is full of bro science, fake knowledge, half information or propaganda. Your quest of reliable, authentic health information ends here. So subscribe this channel and hit the bell icon and you never have to go anywhere else ever again.
First of all, thank you, Sumit, for having me here, and thank you for giving this opportunity to address so many people, right? It's very, very important for people to know about these kind of things. And there are so many wrong information out there, and most commonly people come with these kind of myths that they would switch to some kind of, for example, I'll let you, like salt, for example, right? If people, most of the people who come to me, they have switched to Sendha Namak or either Himalayan salt or Tata salt. They have stopped using all that salt. But what has happened, the incidence of thyroid dysfunction has increased. Now, nobody is thinking about it. Why? Because, there was a time where everybody used to have goiters. Everybody used to have big, big thyroid. And then government decided that salt needs to be iodized so that people can get iodine in their diet. And the recommended amount of iodine should come at least 80-90% from that salt itself. And what has happened now, people are using non-iodized salt. Not that anything is bad in Sendha Namak or Himalayan salt or anything else. The only thing is that it's not iodized. So they are not getting that part of iodine which they require for thyroid production. That's why there are so many increased amount of hypothyroidisms in the country. Just because of wrong information, right? It's not that these refined salt is bad or it's like a poison. No, it's nothing like that, right? Everything which is refining means cleaning. Basic cleaning is refining. That does not mean that things will go bad or would become poison. This is just one example. Secondly, because I'm a cardiologist and people come to me for heart problems and stents and other to ask about these reasons, and one of the common mistake conception they have is that stents have an expiry date and stents they have complications, they go wrong. See, it's basically like a clogged pipe in your home. If you have a drainage pipe which gets clogged, you ask a plumber to come and clean it up with a wire. He basically ducks the hole, he basically cleans, takes out the whatever is choking the wire, this thing, pipeline, and he basically cleans the wire. That's what we do as a cardiologist. We basically put a wire inside those arteries and then clean the clot, suck the blood clot, whichever is there, and then so that the arteries become wide open, then we put a stent which basically stays there for life. It does not have any expiry date. It does not get clogged because we have given a small trauma there. Internally, we are cleaning there. So there is internal injury. That's why we have to give medicines for at least 6 months, 3 months. These are necessary. That's why doctors say that don't stop the medicines, right? So people have a different conception, misconception, and this myth is a very common myth that stents cause a problem or salt cause a problem. You're understanding my point. So this is just a couple of examples. There are so many more such examples which I can tell you about, right? So that's how it is. Not at all. Trekking and regular exercise. See, trekking is like it's a challenging exercise. See, everyone should undergo some kind of challenging exercise depending upon their physical ability, obviously. I wouldn't ask somebody who cannot walk on stairs to go on trekking, obviously. But a person who is fit, who wants to stay fit, trekking is one of the best things which he can do. Because having challenging your physical efforts is not just good for your blood pressure. Yes, people are afraid about blood pressure. Many times they come to me and ask them whether I can exercise during high blood pressure or not, whether it is good for blood pressure or not. It's actually rather beneficial for blood pressure. If you are regularly exercising, going on trekking, your blood pressure stays low. Because you are increasing your blood pressure intentionally during that exercise and then resting. The benefits are not just on blood pressure, on heart. Your heart attack chances will reduce drastically if you are regularly doing trekking or rather any kind of physical exercise which are challenging. Then it is good for your mood, it is good for your sleep, not just for sleep, but most important thing, stress. stress is a big factor in this today's world, and this kind of exercise is good for, you know, not just your physical but mental ability, mental performance. It becomes very, very important that you do some kind of activity, and then sense of achievement, the fresh air which you see when you go up on that mountain, right, the pictures which you show, right, the social interaction which you have, there is nothing like it. I'm sure you must be, you know, you understand, you are a trekker, right? I have gone for a trekking like this a couple of times myself. So I would support this completely, that everyone who is able to do that should go on a trekking sometime or the other. Yeah, that's a very important question. Quite frankly, it's a regular message which I give out to my patients as well. See, this is an internet era. Everybody goes out on the internet searching for information, no matter if it is about their, you know, if it is about a cooking recipe, or if it is about their health, or a blood test reports, or any kind of medicine. The problem with internet is it does not have a scrutiny that what kind of information is authentic or not. Right, even you can write, even anybody can write about any topic, no matter if they have any kind of specialization on that or not, right? And whenever you type a word, say you are tracking trekking or blood pressure, anybody who has written any kind of blog or any website who is authentic by a doctor or not, it will come up and you will read that thing. Depends upon what kind of SEO those people are doing just to put their content on the top of other content. So what I will advise is that whosoever wants to find out reliable, authentic health information online should understand a couple of things. Number one, they have to find out who has written the information. If it is not by a doctor, not by a person who is specializing in that field, it's not authentic, it's not worth even reading. Then second thing, they have to understand the duration, the time. You cannot rely on health information way back 20 years back or 30 years back, because medical science is changing, diseases are changing, environment is changing, everything is changing. So the knowledge should be current, within 5-10 years. That's how you need to search. And the most important is you have to find out reliable websites. You cannot go on searching on any .com, right? Health.com, etc. .com. So you have to rely on websites which are either by the government, or there is a website called Medline Plus, which is by the US National Medical Library, made specifically for patient education. People can refer that, quite frankly. And then researches can be seen on PubMed directly. There are so many important aspects, but the most important is who has written this kind of information, who is giving you the information, and whether it is real or not, whether there is any research on that, or it's just a postulation, where it's basically a hypothesis. So you have to understand all these points, and then after, you know, analyzing all these things, then you change anything which you want to change about your health. That too, if it is about medicine, if it's about tests, then you should consult your general practitioner, your GP, so that you don't go wrong. So that's how a person should actually go forwards if they want to use the internet's knowledge to change their health, right? That's how you can be healthy, you can stay healthy and stay fit.